Money is a reflection of how you have devalued your own worth. So to reclaim your worth through any spiritual practice or uprising is bound to change any system of exchange that a collective or planet is operating in. But it's complex, we know, because money has become more than a system of financial exchange. It has become a part even of your human identity, as many are truly defining their sense of self through an accumulation of material wealth and money. And this, we believe, must fully break down in order for the hierarchies that sustain it to also be banished.
I'd like to welcome to the show Micheila Sheldan. How are you doing, Micheila?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me, Alex.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. I truly appreciate it. I'm excited to talk to you because of your work and what you're doing in the world. And anytime I get to talk to a channel is always entertaining and always educational, always profound. And every channel has a different story on how they got into this. So first question I have for you is, what was your life like before the insanity that is channeling came into your life?
Not as insane. I lived a very normal, societally accepted, conventional life. I grew up here in Detroit, east side suburb, automotive town. My dad worked on the line at GM. My mom was a nurse. You know, I oldest of three children, went to school, did all that stuff, went to Catholic church and catechism after school, did all of that, went to college, got married, had children, really didn't step into this insane world of channeling till much later in my life.
So were you were raised religious? Are you a recovering Catholic, same as me?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Yes, I am. Yeah.
So were you religious, even though you were raised religious? Were you religious or were you more spiritual, or did you kind of lean into this kind of more metaphysical lifestyle?
There was no metaphysical or real religious bone in my body, to be honest. I mean, I remember going through the motions, right? Of getting on the bus, going to catechism on Tuesday and Thursday after school, you know, did the communion and all that stuff. But to be honest, it never, I don't remember it having a huge impact on me, only enough that it was just a family tradition, right? My father was a very strict Italian Catholic, and his side of the family grew up with all of that. And I, you know, when I got married and had my own children, I just instinctually, you know, raised them in all of that as well. But came to a point when I really started to question it and, you know, had a completely different perspective of what it was. So no, I can't say that, you know, even, you know, now that I'm channeling, to be honest, I have more memory of being in those places and what those stories were than actually, I think, when I was a child and when I was there. So more deepened in my spiritual connection today than I ever was, you know, before.
So when did you first discover that you had the ability to channel? Because it doesn't seem like you were searching for it. Many channels are looking for it or studying it. All of a sudden, did a voice just come down from the heavens and going, Micheila, it's time?
Well, yeah, to be honest, I had no at all experience. I didn't even know what the word channeling was. I had no quest to be on a spiritual path whatsoever. And, you know, I would say this started around my late 30s, early 40s. And for me, it was a serious physical crisis. I lived this wonderful life. I was a very successful career woman, had my children, and then, you know, dropped the career and decided to stay at home and put all of that energy into being a stay-at-home mom. And after the birth of my second child, I started to struggle with chronic pain. It was in my hip and my back and my leg. And I was on this, you know, conventional Western medicine path where every January, I get my new insurance card to go see a new doctor. I get new prescriptions and tests and MRIs and the whole bit. And really it was just getting worse and worse and worse. And washing down pain meds with alcohol, right? It wasn't getting any better. So I ended up in it was just a mystical time in my life. I was in this really wonderful neighborhood. I was the PTA vice president. I was the epitome of the soccer mom. I did all the volunteer work. I loved it, loved it, loved it there. And my husband at the time had gotten a new job and really wanted us to make a move across town. And I had been putting my foot down because I did not want to move myself or my children. We were so happy there. And I had a lot of support there. So I had a lot of people around me who were picking up the slack when the pain was bad and I couldn't get the kids off the bus or asking, take on my grocery list for me and things like this. Well, it was very strange in that one day I got up 5 in the morning, agreed to move, and started packing the house, almost as if I was on automatic pilot. Found myself across town in an unfamiliar place with new people, tried to make my old life work, and it just fell apart. Everyone hated me. Nobody wanted me in the PTA. Nobody wanted me to be the soccer mom. My kids were struggling, and I was very stressed. The stress was building and increasing the pain in my body. So it really got to a point where I stopped driving. I didn't trust myself to hit the brake
Wow.
pedal. My legs were going numb. I was pretty sick. And, I was getting ready to turn 40. I had to take a hard look at myself in the mirror, right? So the first thing that I think happened, and I think there were many things that happened to led to this breaking open of my channeling was, I chose to move to a house that had a reverse osmosis filter in the basement that filtered the fluoride out of the water. Now, I had no idea. I just thought it was a fancy filter that made the water taste better. But I started questioning a lot of things once I moved into that house. And one of the things that started to happen was I was exposed more to metaphysical types of modalities. And I began to read more about meditation because it had come into my awareness that meditation could help me to manage the pain. And I was so tired of all the medications and right, getting worse and worse. So I thought it's worth a shot. Nothing else is working for me. I'm done with the doctors. I'm going to start just trying to meditate. Well, without even watching a video or doing a training course, I just decided to lay down and breathe. And I believe this was a breath practice that I have done in many, many lifetimes because in that first meditative effort, I went into like a full Kundalini experience. And it was very profound and blissful. And I thought, this is what I've been missing out on right, this whole time. So I'm going to, dedicated as ever. I noticed it was making a difference in my stress level. I noticed it was making a difference with my pain. So I'm a go-getter. I'm like, I'm going to do this 3 times a day, right? For at least a half hour, if not more, set up the schedule and started to do it. And then very weird things started happening. So the more I was meditating, I was hearing voices, I guess what I call voices. And, I just thought my mind was real active and making things up, right? But I was starting to question whether these voices were my own. But then I started having weird experiences outside of meditation. So I'd be talking to somebody in a grocery store, for example, and I would hear something that they didn't say to me out loud. And it would be very personal. And I would question myself when I got in the car, like, did they really say that to me? And if they said it, I didn't respond. That was really rude. And so I was just really going through this whole thing. And I started to explore clairaudience because it was safer to me to consider what I was experiencing clairaudience than actually channeling. Well, I had this defining moment. All right. So things are building, things are building. I'm, meditating more, I'm opening up more. And it was Christmas Day. And I had the big house and I was the oldest. So I always have the family over, right? Big family dinner at Christmas. And I was preparing a meal and a special recipe that required a lot of unusual ingredients, right? So I get up that morning, excited to make the meal, marinate the roast. I go into the pantry and realize I forgot to purchase 3 very key ingredients that I needed for this meal. And I couldn't believe it. You know, I got on a stool, I was pushing things around, and I started to get stressed. And to me, stress equaled pain. So that says straight to meditation, even on Christmas morning. So I told the kids, Mom needs a few minutes. I went into the bedroom, closed the door, and I went into a very deep meditation. And I heard three words that forever changed my life. And those words were, I am Jacob. And it was a male voice, very loud, as if in the room with me. I even opened my eyes to look around, thinking someone had walked into the room. But more so, I had this blissful kind of peace come over me. It was a feeling I had never felt before. And it didn't occur to me to ask Jacob any questions, or to try to have a conversation. I was just so enlightened, I think, by this encounter that I thought, you know, this is Christmas. It's silly. I'm just going to go out there and fix this whatever with whatever I've got. Went to the pantry, opened the door, and there on the shelf in three sealed containers right at eye level were the three ingredients that I needed to make this recipe. And I thought, wow, I'd manifested something physical into my reality because I had started to dabble in the ideas of law of attraction. Or I thought maybe Jacob heard me and, you know, was trying to show me or prove to me that he was real, but I didn't care. You know, I put it aside. I didn't talk about it or think about it and made the dinner and just had a wonderful day. But that sent me on a quest to understand who Jacob was, what I was hearing, what was going on with me. And from there, it just spiraled into something pretty amazing.
So that's the very first time Jacob came to you, and you're still kind of
Yes.
dealing with it. You're kind of still you put it aside, as they say in the hero's journey. You refuse the call to act to the adventure. You're like, I don't
I
even
did.
know. N next time, next time. I don't know what's going on. So
Yeah.
as this progressed, since you really didn't understand or you weren't studying particularly this. Did you think you were kind of losing your mind? Because when you hear voices,
Oh.
I mean, this is generally what
Absolutely.
did you? How did you deal
Yeah.
with it? How
Oh,
did you
yeah.
start dealing with this psychologically?
I don't know if I did deal with it very well psychologically, actually. You know, for me, it was just I became very curious. You know, I didn't take the normal paths of seeking out a teacher or an instruction manual or a book. I really just dove in and started to do it more. So in my meditations, these conversations became longer and more complex. And I began to ask questions and get answers. And I was tapping into more than just this being Jacob. And actually, my first question was, who are you? You know, I wanted to know who Jacob was. And I found out that Jacob and I had a very special relationship from a past life where he was a young boy who was lost, and I took him in as my own and I cared for him and raised him. I later found out that guides will present themselves to people like me who aren't really into this world in very acceptable, right? And simple ways. And I think that it's more multidimensional than that, right? I later understood Jacob to be so many different beings and souls. You know, we have had relationships in so many lives beyond that one. And he was like a gatekeeper to me, meaning he was there to get me onto the path of channeling and introducing me to new guides, beings, and collectives that I would be working with. And he told me that I was here with a mission and that I was meant to help humanity to move through a very difficult period of transition on the earth. And to do that, I would be channeling through me messages that would be very useful. And I wanted nothing, absolutely nothing to do with that. I said, that sounds great, but thank you for your consideration. But that was not the path that I was on, you know, in life, nor was that an easy thing for me to accept. So it took me a great many years to really come out of the closet because that's what happened is I started to channel in my closet. And I would ask a question or I would hear something the response, for example, and I would write it. So I was doing a lot of journaling around that time, where the message would come, I would write it down, and then I would hear the next message. And then things started happening so fast. The messages were longer and more complex. And one day I thought, I'm just going to hit record on my iPhone and then speak the messages right into the phone. And that's where, again, the next level change happened in me, where I realized it wasn't me at all, because I heard my voice change. You know, I heard myself talking in ways or about topics, things, you know, that it just wasn't me. These were not things that I knew about, concepts I'd never heard before, beings coming in like Pleiadians that I didn't even know. And believe me, I wasn't even a believer in extraterrestrials. So I'm looking up the word Pleiadian going, you know, this was my journey to believing in things that I just really had no, you know, framework for whatsoever.
It
In
sounds
addition, I had
so
no one really around me.
right,
Go ahead.
exactly. You didn't have a support system around you to kind of help you. You weren't looking for this. You weren't studying this. It's kind of thrust upon you. I got to imagine that as this continues to unravel in front of you, you must feel alone in many ways because you didn't have, grandma didn't have the gift, or something along those lines that you could talk to someone about this. How did you come out of the channeling closet eventually, to your family, to your colleagues, to your friends? How did that work out?
Yeah, it was an interesting period of my life, like a death and a rebirth, because I feel like I've lived two different lives in the same timeline. So I think like a magnet, you know, channeling will pull you into all of the right situations, experiences, and people, right, that resonate with what you're doing. And that's truly what happened with me. It was kind of miraculous. Actually, I was sent on this path, not only of physical healing, and by the way, I did heal my body 100%, but the synchronicities in my life became so vivid that I was now meeting people who were so interested in my channeling that they wanted me to do it for them. I was having conversations with people about things that, you know, started to resonate more and more. And as that was happening, I was being sucked out of, you know, an old life that really didn't make sense anymore. So the more I was meditating, the more I was channeling, the more the material world around me started to shift to match that experience. And so it wasn't easy. And certainly I was petrified to tell my family, especially my very Italian Catholic father, that I was a channel. But it got to the point where I just couldn't deny anymore the life that I was here to live. And little by little, you know, I started letting the cat out of the bag. So it was a gradual process. It didn't happen overnight, which I think was good for me, because to snowball like that so quickly would have really been, you know, hard to manage. But you know, there were friends who wanted me to channel for them, and then they were pulling in their friends that I didn't know that then wanted me to channel for them. And then, you know, I met my now partner, Ethan Fox, who ran an organization, Flower of Life Institute. And it's interesting. So my background is in marketing, and I met Ethan, you know, again, very synchronistically. He was doing an energy transfer here locally in town. And I went just to have the experience and ended up volunteering to support an expo that he was pulling together, spiritual expo, consciousness-based, right, expo. And there was a channel lined up to offer a transmission in front of, you know, the audience. And at the very last minute, this channel backed out. And he looked at me and said, "It was always meant to be you." And I never, ever would have done anything like that had I not had the support system around me or the people around me, you know, to help me to do it. So it's pretty magical. As
And
it wasn't easy, but magical.
yeah, imagine on a psychological standpoint that death and rebirth, which I completely understand, by the way, in my own way, from leaving Hollywood and starting a spiritual podcast. It was very similar in the way that it kind of mo literally moved from Hollywood, left LA, moved to Austin, set up shop, all that thing. It was, I'm still going through it. I'm still kind of going through that death of the old version of myself and the new version that has, that everything's so synchronic, the synchronicities on this side of the fence is so insane that you can't ignore it. And you're like, but I spent 30 years over there. And you know, and you're like, but is that, I mean, do I just let that go? And do I like, am, it's a very difficult process. It is a difficult process. Not nearly as difficult as yours, by the way, but it's a version of it.
Yeah, I think interestingly, and what I've learned is I really think it's all very purposeful. I believe that, that period of my life where I was a mother and raised children and, all the things that I did,
Sure.
they really interestingly align with what I'm doing today and in many respects prepared me
Yes.
to do this work.
Yes.
So I don't think anything goes to waste. We take it with us and it gets reconfigured and repackaged in this new way.
And it's interesting because I agree with you 100% that the skill set that I have from working in Hollywood have definitely helped me build out this show, build out what I'm doing, and all that kind of stuff. But the wants and the things that were important to us, being those people, don't really interest either of us now. Is that fair?
That absolutely, and I think that is a part of the journey. Soul contracts shift, and I think we attract the things that take us to the next highest level. And I think discomfort is inevitable. That's really what I've learned from the guides. Suffering is a choice, but discomfort is inevitable because in those uncomfortable periods where we're being stretched to the limit, to trust in something that we have no foundation to believe in. We grow tremendously, right? And that's, I still have learned to invite that into my life because I've always thought, oh, that phase is now done. I finally, left the old life behind. And then, I find myself going back time and time again to things that I really didn't close the door on or complete within me. And I think that's the beauty of the journey is, we're always being challenged and pushed. And that's what's happening on the earth, right now as a whole, the collective right now through very uncomfortable and challenging situations, we're being stretched, in our faith and in our beliefs and in what we're capable of, to become better people.
Now, every channel has a different process and it works differently through them. What is your process for channeling? Do you get energized? Do you get weakened? Do you remember everything? Do you not remember everything? Do you sit right next door, or do you go somewhere else? What is your process for channeling?
Well, it's changed a lot over the years, and I am a trance channel, although I can channel, both in trance as well as more consciously. But I've always, totally forgotten, never really been connected to the information as it's been coming through me. And my process, it's kind of funny. I bilocate, and what I started to do was kind of put myself in an astral car and drive it into the next room. So for me to channel for someone else or even a group of people, I consider that a huge responsibility. And I do not want my mind, my ego, any part of me involved in the process. So I put myself somewhere else, and I see myself driving into a familiar space, a room in a home, or if we're at an event, a place that I've visited there. And I'm more of an observer. Now, I can't possibly remember all the details that come through me, but what's interesting is I have this kind of dual experience going on. So I can be sitting in the corner thinking, I wonder what time it is, or, oh, I'm getting hungry. I hope lunch is on the way. Well, words are coming out of my mouth that are completely different. So it is kind of strange. I have varying levels of consciousness depending upon what I'm channeling and who I'm channeling for, and of course the beings that are here. And I typically walk away with the gist, I say. So anything that comes through me becomes a part of me. And I'm a student of the teachings and the guides just as much as anyone who comes to me for a channeling. So I get the benefit of walking away and questioning my reality and putting some of the things that the guides have taught into the framework of my life. But yeah, my process is pretty simple. I get myself out of the way, and then I become an observer of varying levels of consciousness.
Who do you channel on a regular basis? Because I've heard that you, in our conversation, that you've do multiple entities, whoever's here. Is it Jacob? Is it a group? Is it a collective? Who are you channeling, generally speaking?
I'm a very open channel. So I can channel pretty much any entity, collective, or being that is requested of the highest light. Now, Jacob is not someone I channel anymore. It was kind of interesting. At one point, Jacob came in and told me his work with me was done, which kind of shocked me. It was a little heartbreaking because he was by my side, but I consider him more of a personal guide. I moved into collectives like the Pleiadians, for example. Very early on, and still today, I channel Mary Magdalene quite often. Many of the Ascended Masters, for example, I've channeled Syrians. The Council of Light is another collective that I channel quite frequently. So it's really across the board.
Well, would you mind doing a channeling session today? I have a few questions that my audience always brings out.
Yes,
So
absolutely.
now how do we
Sure.
if you it's basically a buffet. I don't know who to ask for. So you
Well,
tell me, you tell me.
here's my suggestion. You go ahead and lead the session and ask your questions, and we'll just bring in the guides or collectives that are best suited to provide the answers. And I will always define, announce who's here so we know who we're speaking with.
All right. And how long
Sound
does it
good?
take you to come in and come out and go out? How long does it take you to come in
Not
and go
long
out?
at all. Not
Okay.
just a minute or two. Yeah, we
All
can
right.
start in just a second.
Okay.
All right. We have an assembly of ascended masters and teachers that are ready to support you in whatever direction you choose to go.
Thank you so much for being here today. My first question is, how can understanding the spiritual dimensions of war help us find peace in our world?
This is the collective, the Ascended Masters. We will speak through this channel as a one voice. And we understand that throughout history, space, and time, war has existed. But to frame it within various dimensions or spiritual planes is to sometimes put complexity in the way of the true resolution that you desire, because war has much to do with the repeat of history that many of you have been asked to attune to energetically. And that history, it does not just manifest in the form of war on the planet collectively. It manifests within families. It manifests between neighbors. It is a division that is being falsely created within the human collective. So we have to start first within ourselves, because if we are interdimensional beings, then we have access through all planes of existence to the most powerful essence of truth at our disposal, which is self-knowing. If we know ourselves to be present within all planes of existence, and we are willing to use a conscious perspective through which we review every thought, every action, every expression of energy that we intentionally make, then we will expand ourselves beyond war simply because the level of compassion that we achieve for others that flows from within us can no longer allow these types of experiences to continue. In other words, war, it manifests through a seed of hatred, which does not allow an access to the highest frequency known as love. So if we are hating anything within ourselves, if we are hating anything within the world, if we believe that the world is going awry and in order to change it, We must angrily stand in defense of things that we believe are going wrong. We are only tending to that seed of hatred in such a way that it will grow. Yet we know many of you intend to interface directly in physical material ways with the wars that are taking place on your planet today. And we say those actions are always most beneficial when you align within you your intention. Meaning if that intention is coming from the pure space of love, a container that is not contaminated with righteousness or having to find justice, you will make the biggest impact as you move between these dimensions and ultimately find within you the peace that is the foundation for healing anything that is not of its equal measure.
Could you share insights on the most affected spiritual practices to overcome the fear in our lives?
We are Divine Mother. Fear is a necessary evil, not only on the physical planet that you have chosen to incarnate on, but throughout the universe. Fear should first not be seen as something that prohibits a soul from reaching its true and highest power. Many of us who were trained early on in the mystery schools learned to use fear as the energy and agent upon which we would create things that could no longer let it survive. In other words, we did not find fear and then attempt to release it. We channeled the fear into some of our most profound and meaningful teachings. So the practice becomes not resisting the fear, nor allowing it to challenge you to the depths of what your soul believes is insufficiency, but to allow yourself to feel it to its greatest depth. Because if there is one thing we believe that is the most powerful practice for humans to evolve, it is to allow a spectrum of emotion and experiences to be what they are. You have the bandwidth within you to accept whatever experience comes your way. And as you feel into what it is causing within your own soul, within your own heart, transmute it with very little effort. Because feeling is sometimes merely the energy shifting within the field of your body, within the field of your earth experience, within your entire collective. So do not fear fear. Invite it in. And then use it as the tool through which you find more courage. Use it as the platform upon which you stand to share more love. But own it as if it is your own. Because when we resist anything, when we define anything as unworthy of ourselves or taking away our power, we are putting it into a material manifestation that we do not desire.
What is the biggest challenge for humanity in this upcoming year?
We are the Council of Light. And while we see many individual challenges that we could define for you in the framework of your societal structures, for example, we would prefer to take this up a notch to what's going on within each individual, because in order to truly bridge the gap between the old and the new, room for the new must be made. And we're seeing perhaps an accumulation of density and resistance, even fear of letting go of what can no longer come with you that you believed kept you safe. In fact, we think that moving through this transitional period is going to require a more so release of the ego and any association with traumas that you still hold you back and you believe that you need to heal. Ultimately, healing comes when we allow the trauma to show us how far we have come. And instead of taking an account or a measure of who is yet to ascend or how far each of you have come in your own evolution, our advice is to drop those measurements, because where you are going, there is nothing that can measure in a very reliable way what you are about to experience. And ultimately, we think that you're tethered to many material manifestations that are beginning to weather through a shift of vibrations so strong that they truly cannot remain. The only way to release yourself from these remaining vibrational ties is to step into the mystery of what you do not know with the faith and trust of an army of angels, even your cosmic families. For those of us who assemble as one voice, as the Council of Light, we have weathered these many storms ourselves. And what we know is that the more you surrender to the future you do not know, yet are curating through faith, the less you will hold on to the things that are not allowing that new timeline to be birthed.
Well, where are we going as a species in the coming years?
As the Council of Light, we recommend that all of you envision this in very unrealistic ways and to your most fulfilling and wildest dreams, because you are not creating something that is stagnant. So for us to define it would be to already place a limitation and a contradiction upon what it can be. This is why we hesitate to prophesize about what exactly you are stepping into. But we can give an analogy and want to speak for a moment about the great spiral of time, which you are all connected to. And this spiral is the true foundation upon which you are creating. You are not creating from nothingness. It is just that you have lived on the same rung of the spiral for so many years that you are repeating things that are causing more suffering. But the good news is this: all of the ancient history and enlightened civilizations of the past exist within that spiral. Highly technological ages like Atlantis, love-based societies, and conscious lifestyles lived in Lemuria. The beautiful construction of pyramids and healing chambers in Egypt. These are the timelines that we see many of you tapping into right now. And it is not to say that you're bringing them back from their past into this present moment in the same way. The beauty of this is that you are taking the sheer vibration of the Akashic relevance of this history, and you are transforming it and molding it like the potter molds the clay into something very unique that has never been seen before in this universe. That is ultimately the goal. And so we see more conscious communities where humans are supporting each other without having to default to any global support system. We see going back to the earth and seeding healing gardens, living in relationship with nature, but not having to subscribe to any dogma that is put upon you that tells you you must do this in a certain way. For if we are relating to earth personally as souls, then we will know exactly what to do in order to expand that relationship into the best version of what it can possibly be. So some of the more restrictive and we might say distorted relationships to the past that you have been replaying, that are seen very vividly now with the level of transparency that humans have acquired, are going to begin to break down. In fact, they are becoming far more restrictive in your soul's ability to relate to them and actually live from the sovereign nature of your true human blueprint. This new earth that is prophesized, it is something that is going to be more cosmic in its orientation, meaning you will not see only the earth as a home for humans, but invite in the relationships that you have known from the beginning of time with all of your cosmic families. This is not disclosure in the way that it has been discussed on your planet, a great reveal of what has been hidden to you. You all already feel these relationships within your hearts and within your souls. And now you will be free to bring these relationships into a higher state of evolution.
How do you foresee the concept and role of money evolving spiritually in the next 5 to 10 years?
We are the Pleiadians, and we are pleased to provide our insights on your financial system, knowing, of course, that money has evolved on planet Earth, not in a spiritual sense whatsoever. In fact, money is a reflection of how you have devalued your own worth. So to reclaim your worth through any spiritual practice or uprising is bound to change any system of exchange that a collective or planet is operating in. But it's complex, we know, because money has become more than a system of financial exchange. It has become a part even of your human identity, as many are truly defining their sense of self through an accumulation of material wealth and money. And this, we believe, must fully break down in order for the hierarchies that sustain it to also be banished. What we notice, however, is anytime a new reality is being birthed, there are signs of what is yet to come all around you. For example, any of the currencies that are not currently tied to a consolidated system that proclaims ownership upon it are the ones that are paving the way for the new monetary system that you will transition into. And there are many timelines that you have created as humans that you can step onto in relationship to this new monetary timeline. Again, we know you see these very vividly. They are as transparent as looking through a newly cleaned window. But how you relate to money is going to be the basis for how it comes into your experience. The equalization of financial currency is something that we know many are focused on. And we think that the intention that is fueling this desire to equalize financial abundance across the board is not what you believe it is. It has nothing to do with money and everything to do with eliminating suffering. So keeping in mind the elimination of suffering, what you will see if you walk that timeline in the future is a freeing of your collective monetary system, whereby there will be many different systems that you will be able to choose from and operate within that may exist in different levels of consciousness, but will work their way out of the hierarchical structures that they have been imbued within for a very long period of time. Ultimately, do we think you're going back to ancient tribal periods of exchange where there is no monetary system? We think it is possible, yet we don't think making that leap in such a short period of time is truly comfortable for a collective that is moving through space and time so quickly. And that means the universe is going to support you exactly where you are. You're going to see more of a gradual shift in your monetary systems. And in the interim, we implore you to choose the ones that resonate more with your soul and the lifestyle that you are choosing to lead, ultimately leading to the freedom you desire.
What guidance can you offer for balancing material needs with spiritual growth?
We are the Pleiadian Collective. Material needs are perhaps a part of every soul's spiritual path. And you must remember that if you chose to incarnate in a physical body on a physical planet, then you wanted to interface with energy as material. In fact, everything that you've accumulated in your physical life was created by you energetically long before it even came into your peripheral. That is how important the relationship is between everything that you see in the material world and what you call your own spiritual evolution, an interesting internal soul journey. The material issue that we most observe that is changing on planet Earth in relationship to spiritual awakening is that material is becoming more purposeful. What has been taken away from the manifestation process is true purpose behind material and how it comes into your life, not only to serve you, but to fuel the service and purpose that you are choosing. Many have already begun making this shift in their life where they have purged things that have no apparent connection to their truth or their vibration or what they are here to do. In fact, we do believe that material abundance can weigh down a soul's spiritual evolution if it has been rooted in things like societal acceptance, or forming an identity based upon those things. This is what you're walking away from. And what that means is you're streamlining your manifestation process. You're actually letting go of having to have anything material at all. And in the process, the source field is orchestrating for you the very things necessary to put you on a trajectory of purpose. This includes moving to new geographic regions. It also includes leaving things behind that you may have thought were necessary to keep you safe in a physical reality. That, we believe, is also an important theme that many will have to consider. There are a great many material things, structures even, that humanity has adopted in a sense of safety. These are the things that we put in our lives just in case something might happen in the future. But every time you have done this, you have taken yourself out of the quantum field where the most powerful forms of manifestation actually exist. So you're learning to be more quantum and in the present moment. And in this way, drawing in a moment's notice the things that are not only important to you, but will collectively reassemble a matrix of helping hands that purports unity consciousness. We think this is where you are going more so, is taking material manifestation into a more unified and quantum field where it's not only beneficial for the earth and beneficial for each individual, but there is symbiosis and sharing and a sense of prosperity that comes not from ownership, but more so a sharing economy.
What spiritual advice would you give for navigating economic changes that are coming?
Again, as the Pleiadians, it is inevitable that you will go through periods of discomfort where the very things that you relied on will not be either available or function in the way that you expect. But remember, the beginnings of the new still exist all around you. We consider consciousness like a bandwidth of perception. It is much like the lens on a camera. You have the option to look very closely and examine with great detail the things that are going wrong, or you also have the ability to widen the lens and the scope to truly perceive all of the things that are going right. Because anytime there is a perceived problem, the solution for that problem has already been born and exists. The problem is, if we are not in the quantum reality where that solution is already budding itself and seeding new experiences, then we won't intersect with it. So our advice is this: as you see the decline of your economic systems, as things are going awry in your material world, do not rush or in haste take the paths that you believe will create safety, and especially take an inventory of where your actions stem from intentionally. If you are acting from fear, you are only strengthening the timelines that you do not desire. Our advice is to use the breath and to pause and to use the perspective of consciousness to seek out the paths less traveled, the things that may seem unreasonable and risky that are actually coming into being right now to replace the old. And in the interim, it may be that you are bridging both realities. There may need to be some interaction with the old while the new is better understood or strengthened. It is somewhat like keeping a toe in a muddied pond while the other foot is stepping into a clearer one. This is ultimately what you will be doing in all experiences of your life. And to put the pressure and the burden on yourself to make this quantum leap in an unnatural way is something we also want to discuss, because there is a great deal of conversation within spiritual circles about jumping from one timeline to another and leaving one fully behind. And we never advise this, because what you are growing in the new is birthed from the old. There are aspects of what you have manifested in your old reality that become the foundation for what is being seeded in the new. So if we're looking at things through the stark view of judgment, what is right and what is wrong, we may lose our footing. These are times where we may not take full advantage of all of the things that exist at our disposal. You are learning how to live in a more multidimensional reality. And there is truly no instruction manual for that. Even those of us in Pleiades who have walked similar transitions as you could never recommend any one thing for any one individual. And that is why you must go deep within your own internal GPS and intuition to say, this is where I will remain and this is where I will go. And it is okay, because both are navigating me into the reality that is the next best expression of my truth.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
We are the Council of Light. As always, we're so honored to interact with all of you, but want to remind you that we are not a collective of intergalactic beings that exist well beyond the Earth. All of you interact with us and through agreement are a part of our council. You were seated within the legacies and the purest lineages of our cosmic families. And we are here to support you as you are one with us. Lean on us often. And we're very pleased not to provide the way necessarily, but to instill within you the courage to know that the way is birthed through your own energy field. Many blessings.
Thank you. And she's back. How are you doing?
Very good. Thank you.
Good, good. How do you feel?
Light and wonderful.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. And
I can feel a little tense and come out feeling expanded. So
did you hear anything, or you did hear some stuff and you just don't remember it?
I can't know. What will happen? I don't remember anything that was just said, but what typically happens is later in the day, I might have some flashbacks of certain things or messages, right?
Like a dream.
Blips. Thing. Yeah. Like a dream. I can always remember the guides that we spoke to. Sometimes I get visions. I clearly remember those, but never what's said.
Well, thank you so much for doing that. I appreciate it. I'm going to ask you a few questions.
Thank you. It was my pleasure.
I'm going to ask a few questions that I ask all my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
Being open to change. Ultimately, I think we get an idea of what fulfilled is, and then we're reaching for it somewhere in the future. But I think that definition of fulfillment has to change in every moment, So for me, my mantra is show me where to serve and how I will be served. And to be open to that, to the universe guiding me, is true fulfillment. It means I'm letting go of the expectations and I'm open to the magic of the things that I would not normally see.
You had a chance to go back in time and speak to little Michaela. What advice would you give her?
I would say you're not going to believe what happens later in life. Although I've had some flashbacks of my earlier years, and I do remember having interactions with guides and channeling, but I would say, you're doing okay. Remember to encourage yourself, especially through the hard times, and take advantage of every moment. Even when things are not going your way, what you're creating in every experience is the most important thing that matters.
How do you define God or source energy?
Well, I see God and source energy as two actually different things. I see God as the original source, the creator, who knew not of itself, but began to interact and play with the universe, and the universe responded. And from that response and the bliss and the excitement of knowing something was out there, a source field was born, which is a conglomeration of God sparks. So the guides say we are all a part of the source field. We think it's out there, but we are the ones that the universe or God works through. All of us carries that God spark within us. And the source field is just a conglomeration, orchestration, gathering, great gathering of soul sparks here to support each other.
What is love?
I think that love, and this the guides say this all of the time, is not something that any one individual can define the same as another. It's something that blossoms within us when we remove all of the barriers to it. So what love feels like to me is expanding beyond myself. And I have learned that it is the littlest thing, the smallest things that make the biggest impact when we are reaching for that state. For example, the guides speak often of an angelic voice. We are so hard on ourselves. And one of the biggest measurements of our ascension or our success is to hear all the things we are speaking to ourselves. And I've noticed throughout the years that when I go through hard times or I make mistakes, there's this little voice saying, "It's okay. This is just temporary. You're doing the best that you can." And that to me is love. That's the seed of love, I think, that we grow within ourselves, that we are able to share then with others.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Oh, I think, I've changed my perspective on that so many times. What did a beautiful transmission. I did a beautiful transmission through the Ascended Masters on the journey of the soul. And what they said is when we transition, it's not the big stuff that we look back on. It's not all the things we did wrong and we're adding up all the karma or we're looking at the big successes. It's the moments that we miss that we are in awe of, how incredible those moments were. It's why we reincarnate again. So our purpose is to be present with every moment and to see the beauty in it. And that's what makes the biggest impact here on the planet.
And where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world?
So you can go to my website or you can just search my name, Micheila Sheldon, MichaelaSheldon.com. I have got an archive, tons of free channeled videos on YouTube. You can go to the Awaken Empowered Expo channel or Awaken Empowered TV. You can search and you can find transmissions going back to 2015. I also have a book that I offer for free. It's not published yet. And as we went through our recent difficult years, I put it out on my website while I was editing. So if you go to the book tab, you can sign up. I have communities all over the globe that are reading together and really just gathering together to socialize and interact, which I think is so needed right now. So you can check out my inner circle communities, put your zip code in, join a community. The book is free and you can check that out.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Oh my gosh. I just. Every time that I come on a show like this, and there are so many people gathered around it in interest, it gives me hope as to the direction that we're going. And I think at this time, it's so hard to hold the faith because we're seeing with such clarity all of the things that are going wrong. But this community, those that gather around these videos and that you've put together here, Alex, it really is the foundation and beginning of the new earth. So thank you. Thank you for all that you're doing and for all that the community is doing and gathering around to support.
I appreciate you for coming on the show and for the amazing work you're doing in the world, my dear. Thank you again for coming on.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.